हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल? हाँ, हेलो। ओके, सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विथ अवर टॉपिक, क्विट्स लॉ, बिकॉज वी हैव ए लिमिटेड टाइम पीरियड, 40 मिनट्स। सो आई विल कवर इन ट्राई टू कवर इन शॉर्ट एज पॉसिबल। सो स्टार्ट विथ अवर लास्ट टॉपिक। ओके ओके, ऑलरेडी वी हैव डिस्कस अबाउट डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ मॉडल्स इन शॉर्ट इन लास्ट क्लास। ओके, सो हियर इज द लिंक, यू कैन गो एंड चेक मोर डिटेल अबाउट दिस डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ मॉडल्स। एंड ऑलरेडी वी हैव डिस्कस्ड NPTEL courses related to SCI and then different types of models related to this. And we have already understand about two types of models, descriptive and predictive and descriptive. Okay, so here I will show you again. We already discussed this predictive and descriptive. Okay, this is predictive engineering models and formal. Okay, so there are two types of models. Okay, and we will discuss here predictive. Okay, first we will discuss predictive, then we will go to our GOMS model, and then we will study about KLM and CMM. Okay, so back to our video. Okay, now we will study about Fitts' law. Then Hickman's law is not useful right now in SCI, but we will study the difference between this in short only. Okay, and then to start for Fitts' law, we have to understand about humans. Okay, so we all are humans, but we have to understand about the input-output channels, and that includes visions, hearing, touch, and movements. So movements, it gives our Fitts' law about how to interact with some interactive systems. Okay, so we will start with from vision, hearing, and touch in short. Then we will go to our last topic, movement, Fitts' law. Okay, then we will discuss in detail about this Fitts' law. Okay, so I will start from here, our book. Okay, Human Computer Interactions, and there is a chapter 1, human. Okay, so I assume that you have already have book about this SCI book. Okay, you all got this books from internet. It is available as PDF format online, freely available. So if someone have not this book, then they can go and search about this book. Okay, Human Computer Interactions, and you can get latest edition about this book. So start with our topic, the human. Okay, and already we have discussed about some short-term memory and long-term memory. Okay, so we will not discuss here again. So input output channels. So as we know that we need some input device and output device in computer, as well as we in human, we need input and output. So there are some sensor, you can say sensors, or you can say as a device in human. Okay, for input and for output. Okay, just I am speaking to you. So this is the output. Okay, our sound. Okay, sound is the output from mouth, and for input we have eyes. Okay, we have sensors in bodies. So we will discuss all this here. Okay, so a person interaction with the outside world. I will again 150. Okay, a person interaction with the outside world occur through information being received and sent. So we will need input and output. Okay, And in an interaction with the computer, the user receives information that is output by the computer and respond by providing input to the computer. So we already know about this input and output, so we will not discuss about this outputs and inputs. But here, input in the human occurs mainly through the senses and output through the motor control of the effectors. So we can say these body parts as effectors, or you can say senses. So there are five major senses: sight, hearing, touch, taste, and smell. Okay, so the first three are the most important to SCI: sight, hearing, and touch. Okay, so we will discuss about this three senses. Okay, so first is our vision, human vision. Okay, so already you know that for human, vision is important, and eyes is important, because without eyes one cannot see the whole world or not interact with others. Okay, using eyes, so eyes is important part of the body. Okay, so human vision is highly complex activity with a range of physical and perceptual limitations. There are physical limitations also and perceptual limitations also, because we can view in a limited range of visualization. Okay, you can say there are we can divide visual perception into two stages: the physical reception of the stimulus from the outside world, and then we have to process and interpret that visual prospect, or you can say reception, into actual or real vision. Okay, so there are two stages: first, the physical reception of the stimulus from the outside world, and the second is processing and interpretation of that stimulus. Okay, and in different case, physical properties of the eyes and visual system means that there are certain things that cannot be seen by the human. So something in range of something we can see, okay, but in some ranges we cannot see, because we have limitations. Our eyes have some limitations, physical limitations. Okay, and you can say communication related, you can say waves, visual waves related limitations. Okay, so and after that we have to that processing and interpretation limitations also, because we can identify some colors, okay, some objects. Okay, then we can identify distance, length, but in some case we have we cannot identify the objects, or due to any reason. Okay, any like means if there are raining, then we cannot see further in long distance. Okay, aur aap ye dekh sakte kohre mein bhi hota hai ki aap you cannot see. Theek hai, एक लिमिटेशंस हो जाता है ड्यू टू इन्वायरमेंट इफेक्ट. इन्वायरमेंटल इफेक्ट भी होता है, कभी कभी ह्यूमन रिलेटेड इफेक्ट भी होता है, बिकॉज कि जैसे अगर कहीं पे आग जलाई जा रही है, धुआं है, ब्लैक है थोड़ा, ठीक है, डार्क हो गया, तो उस केस में भी है. अगेन नाइट विजन, नाइट विजन में ह्यूमन की कैपेबिलिटीज बहुत ही लो है, ठीक है, जबकि एनिमल्स की विजिबिलिटी ज़्यादा हो जाती है नाइट में. ओके, सो दीज आर द लिमिटेशंस. तो we will not discuss about human eyes. Okay, only we will get information about some small details. So there is human eyes. So vision begins with light, and eye is the mechanism for receiving light and transforming it into electrical energy. So light is reflected from object in the world, and their image is focused upside down on the back of the eye. So we will not go about this biology related to eyes. So here you can see human eyes. Okay, there are different parts of eyes, and the picture is captured by corona, and then it the lens will focus on 4V. So we will see some images and objects of the real world. Okay, then there are lots of sensors. Okay, retina related, blind spots, ligaments, these are sensors. Okay, so iris also provides some support to eyes to focus it, and it's also a you can say protect the eyes from some outside distractions or obstacles. Okay, so the eye will close automatically using the senses. Okay, then there are visual perceptions. Okay, there are visual perceptions. Okay, we are online. Okay, there is no problem. So I will try to sort and sort. Okay, visual perception. So there are different types of perceptions, but eyes always identify, try to identify and process it using their own mechanisms. Okay, so visual perception is important. The information received by the visual apparatus must be filtered and passed to processing elements, which allows us to recognize coherent scenes, disambiguate relative distances, and differentiate colors. So perception is important. Okay, and it will use in SCA also. Then also we can perceive size, depth, brightness, color. So already we know about this, so we will go to our next. Okay, perceiving size and depth. Okay, so there are some distance related and depth related. Okay, so here you can see picture visual angles. Using angles you can see, so there you can identify the distance and object size using this visual angle. Then there is a perceptive brightness. Brightness is important. Okay, perception will depend on brightness. So using this brightness we can identify also colors, so perceptive colors. Okay, so these are the part of eyes. And then capability or limitation of visual processing. So again there are some ambiguous shape. Okay, for like B we can interpret as 13 if there is some problem in eye mechanism to identify that of characters. So here you can see there is a 13 similar to like B, so there is a ABC. Okay, so again these are some examples. Again this example shows which line is longer. So everyone see that this first line is longer, but both are same, equal. Okay, so this illusion is called as Muller layer illusion. Okay, again there is again example of related to size illusion. Okay, Ponzo illusion, because both are same size, objects are same size. Again some character related problem. Okay, text corrections also. Then this is related to the you can say pixels related issue. Again the size related to size of the fonts related issue. So we can visualize or perceive or imagine about the word or text using our eyes. Now next is reading. So reading is related to eyes also. Without eyes we cannot read. Okay, so we have to focus on something to read text. Okay, or visual patterns. Okay, so we have to decode them also in our mind. If there are different languages, then we have to also interpret in our minds, English to Hindi, Hindi to English, or any other language. Okay, then hearing is also important. And there is a human ear. Okay, that provides some you can say knowledge about the objects. Okay, its properties, its activities. Okay, if we hear some sound related to horn, then we can identify it is a car or bus or you can say train. So we can use here human ear as input purpose. Okay, then processing sound, again we have to process that sound. So there is a mechanism to hear some sounds with limited capabilities, like hear frequencies from about 20 hertz to 15 kilohertz. So we can hear only these sounds. Okay, so above and low these sounds we cannot hear. Okay, then touch, it is most important part of our body. We can have to touch some objects to identify and to interact with them. Okay, this is most important also. So there are three types of sensory receptors, skeins. Okay, we have skeins, and skein contains three types of sensory receptors. Thermoreceptors respond to heat, cold. Nasoreceptors respond to intense pressure, heat and pain. Then mechanoreceptors respond to pressure. So these are three sensory receptors our body for touch, touch process. Okay, then there are more related to this. So rapidly adapting mechanoreceptors, and there are slowly adapting mechanoreceptors. So these are different types of receptors. Okay, so we will go to our final topic, movement. Okay, so movement is important. Okay, because humans have input output channels. Okay, but we have to identify some movement related, or we have to consider motor control and how they will move affects our interaction with computers or any other special devices. So we have to use this input output channels for this capturing this movement. Okay, so here is a simple action such as hitting a button is response to a question involves number of processing stages. Okay, so I will start activate this attendance form. Okay, so you can go and fill this form. Okay, this is the form. Okay, so you can go and fill that form for attendance purpose. Okay, so stimulation is received through the sensory receptors and transmitted to the brain, and again we will use brain that tells the appropriate muscles to respond. So our body will respond, our mechanical parts of body will respond, and then we get reaction times and movement times according to that movement. Okay, then movement is dependent largely on the physical characteristics of the subject, their age and fitness. If there is a child, so his movement is fast. Okay, there is an older person, then the movement is slow. Depends upon the age and fitness. Okay, so here is our Fitts' law. Okay, so I will not go about more detail about this movement, but you can study from this book. Okay, from this resource. So there is speed and accuracy of movement are important consideration in the design of interactive system, because this is related to our human input output channels. Okay, because we have to visualize it, we have to perceive it, and we have to hear it. Okay, so then we can identify the movement about an objects. Okay, so primarily in terms of the time taken to move to a particular target on a screen. Okay, in case of computers, so target may be a button, a menu item, or an icon. So now we see our computers with different softwares, different input devices and output devices. But these designs are come from this laws, Fitts laws. Okay, these models. So we have to identify these laws also. So here is the target of a button, menu items, and then time taken on hit a target is a function of the size of the target. Okay, I will also tell about this Fitts law, how it will be developed, or you can say generated from. Already we have discussed a law related in our telecommunication fundamentals, so I will show that. Okay, so time taken to hit a target is a function of the size of the target and the distance that has to be moved, and this is formalized as Fitts law. And there are many variations of this formula which have varying constants, but they are very similar. Okay, and the common form of this Fitts law is movement time is equal to a plus b log 2 distance divided by size plus 1. Okay, you can see here this formula, and you can identify that formula we all already discussed and used I think in our telecommunication fundamentals. Okay, so having okay, you can fill. Okay, because it's now accepting. input. Okay. And this formula is also you can studied. Okay, sorry. You all already studied about this formula in your 10th or I think 12th. Okay. And here A and B are empirically determined constants. Okay. These are empirically determined constants. So we have, it depends upon mostly the movement about the objects. Okay. Then this affects the type of target we design, and since users will find it more difficult to manipulate small objects, okay, so sometimes this formula will not affect useful for small objects, and targets should be generally be as large as possible, and distance to be moved as small as possible. Okay, distance should be very small. Okay, and this is this has led to suggestion the some pie charts, shaped menus. Okay. And then trade-off to increase use of screen states, and choice may not be so simple according to this formula. So mostly this formula is, now these formulas are not used in modeling SCI, okay, or you can say human computer interactions devices, but earlier these Fitts law is used for designing systems. Okay, and also this laws you can see here that there is a small distance, okay, because small distance, like we have hands and we have to type using keyboards, and we have to use mouse to get the screen, okay, or you can say point the screen. So there is a small movement. Okay, this movement will be captured by this Fitts law. Okay, so the systems here, SCI systems are designed according to Fitts law in earlier times. Okay, now Fitts law is not used, but other models, GOMS related models, are also used to design HCI devices. Okay, so I will go to more detail about this Fitts law. So there is another resource, you can go and get this Mensch machine interaction. Okay, this is written I think in German language, or I think another language. Okay, so okay, I think this is written in German. So Mensch machine interaction. So Mensch means man, and machine and interaction. So here is chapter 9, July. Okay, basic SCI model, and you can identify using this LMU Musens. Okay, this is the university. Okay, so you can find this resource also. So we will not study about all this, only we will study about Fitts law. So again, we already have discussed humans, okay, and there is computer. So human, how human interact with computers. So then we need some design, or you can say device, to interact with the this computer systems. So there is a, you can see here a circle related to design, realization, evolution, and analysis. So it is also a model. Okay, then our main topic is analysis. Okay, so how we have studied about humans input output channels, then identify the Fitts law. Okay, and how it is useful to design some devices, or you can say interaction with SCI. So we will go to our topic related to basic SCI models. So there is a two types of models, predictive model and descriptive models. So today we will study only about predictive models and Fitts law, and here we will not study about steering law. We will learn or discuss this steering law in later you can say topics. Okay, then also we will not study about Heek-Hyman laws here. Okay, I will only show the difference between Fitts and Heek-Hyman law. Okay, so Fitts law introduction. So robust model of human psychomotor behavior to identify movements. Okay, basically movements, and then predict movement time for rapid aim pointing tasks, clicking on buttons, touching icons. Okay, and it is not suitable for drawing and writing. Okay, because we have to consider the small movement only. Okay, only we have to consider small movements. developed by Paul Fitts in 1954 and described movement time in terms of distance plus size of target and device. Again, rediscovered for SCI in 1978. Okay, there is a gap between this development. Okay, 54 to 78. Then subsequently heavily used and discussed in earlier computer systems. Okay. Then Paul M. Fitts was an American psychologist and one of the pioneer in improving aviation safety. Because Paul M. Fitts is not an engineer. Okay, it's an American psychologist, and it is developed this Fitts law for improving aviation safety. Okay, because in aviation already smart systems or computer systems are already used from the earlier times. Okay. You can say real-time systems also there. Okay. Then Fitts' law was his most famous work. It was first mentioned in a publication in 1954 and first applied to human-computer interaction in 1978. Okay. And initially derived from a theorem for analogous information transmission. So already I told that this is related to some theorem. Already you all studied about that theorem. So in school times. Okay. And we will discuss it in telecommunication also. So derivations from signal transmission. Okay, this is a Shannon theorem. Okay, this is a Shannon theorem for signal transmission. So we can say it completely as Shannon-Hadley theorem, but mostly it is called as Shannon theorem. Okay, then C is the channel capacity in bits per second. Okay. Here C is the capacity, B is the bandwidth of the channel in hertz. Okay, like we have A plus B constant. Here B is the bandwidth of the channel. Then S is the total signal power over the bandwidth in volts. Okay, then N is the total noise power over the bandwidth in volts. Again S by N, it is the signal to noise ratio SNR of the communication signal to Gaussian noise interference. So we will study this signal to noise ratio in telecommunication fundamental topic, or you can say I think in a new it is not a telecommunication fundamental topic, it is related to our subject. Okay, subject DCCN, digital communication and computer network. That's subject will cover this signal to noise ratio and channel capacity related to signal transmission, but it is used in our Fitts law. Okay, now we have here Fitts law. So according to Fitts law, the time to acquire a target is a function of the distance to and size of the target and depends on the particular pointing system. So here is the example. Here is the point start and target here, but this distance, or you can say movement, is very small. Okay, and here is the D and here is the W. So MT is equal to A plus B log 2 1 plus D by W. Okay, and then MT is, here MT is movement time. Okay, and A and B is constant, depends on the pointing systems. Also it depends on the device also. Okay, then D, capital D is the distance to the target area, and capital W is the width of the target. So that may be a small point, a large point, but the distance or movement is very small. Okay, so here is the index of difficulty related to Fitts law. Here is the A plus B log 2 1 plus divide by W. So here is the target. Okay, then there is a ID 1, you can say, and then there is a ID 2 is the target 2. There is a target 1 and there is a target 2. So index of difficulty is here ID is equal to log 2 1 plus D divide by W. Okay, so this is our difficulty, because there are two different objects, or you can say points. Then you have to identify the movements related to these objects. So it makes some difficulty. So there is MT is equal to A plus B into ID. So ID describes the difficulty of the task independent of the device method. So it is also considered in mouse also. If you point something like here, so it is shows that it is a different target. Okay, now I will point here, then it is different. So there is a movement. Okay, there is a movement from here to here. Okay, but in case your mouse have a small movement, but in screen you see it is a large movement. Okay, so it is a index of difficulty. Then there are units constant in measured in seconds, and constant to constant A measured in second and constant B measured in seconds by bit, and then index of difficulty ID measured in bits. Okay, so it is our Fitts' law and index of difficulty. Okay, now there are some advanced topics. Okay, so there is a throughput, also known as index of performance or bandwidth. Okay, then single matrix for input systems. Okay, one definition is TP is equal to ID by MT, so average value of ID and MT are used. And there is another different definition is TP is equal to 1 by P. Okay, because the TP is here throughput, so equal to ID by MT, and it's as A is equal to always here 0. Okay, then probability is still the best approach. Okay, using probability you can use regression analysis to compute A and B. Okay, and then you use A 1 by B as throughput cautiously. Okay, so it is fixed 1 by B, we have to identify only B. So here is a there is no need of A, but in case of regression analysis we have to use A and B. Okay, so we will not go to in detail about this regression analysis. Okay, then there is a experiment. Okay, original Fitts law test. Okay, there is a W and there is a D distance. So 1D repeated tapping. In case of 1D, here is the original Fitts law test. But in case of extension to 2D, we need some more details like width and height. Okay, so status queue like use horizontal widths. Okay, then some model is equal W is equal to width plus height. Okay, here is the width and height. Then area model is width into height. Okay, then smaller for W is equal to minimum width and height. So sometimes objects is very small and there is no width and height, so we can use smaller W. Then W model width in movement directions, so there is a direction point also here you can see. Then we finally we got ID is equal to log 2 and under root D by W square plus here is the nota you can say, and D divided by H for height here. Here is the W for width and here is the height, H for height square plus 1. So here is we get ID, the index of difficulty of Fitts' law. Okay, so we will not discuss about this linear regression here. Okay, so implication of SCI 1. So we can use this Fitts' law in various applications, like here bigger buttons and proportional to the amount of views. Okay, so bigger buttons like wavelengths, you can get more buttons, large buttons, and check radio boxes also. Okay, fixed buttons like this radio boxes. Okay, then use current location of the cursor, so we can large the pointer, or we can small the pointer. Okay, then distance is close to zero. Mostly our movement is very small, but in screen it will show like a large movement. Okay, you can say long movement. Okay, then use edges and corners. Okay, edges of the small screen have infinite height or width. So here is the edges, here is the object related to height and width is considered for edges. And again, corners have finite height and width. Okay, so these are considered in our Fitts' law. Then implications of SCI 1, edges and corners again. There is a start button here, large buttons. Okay, but in menus there are small buttons or options. Okay, so one can user can see effectively. So these are the fixed options using Fitts' law. Okay, then implication of SCI, compare and emulate input devices like earlier mouse like system here. Okay, so these are implemented using this Fitts' law. So you can go for additional literature for Fitts' law using this resources: cybernetic understanding of Fitts' law, then bibliography of Fitts' law research, and Fitts' law modeling movement time in SCI. Okay, but mostly we are not using this Fitts' law and Hyman's laws. But in software engineering, Fitts law are mostly used to develop software according to this Fitts law. Okay, but most nowadays the Gomes models are used. Okay, so I will go to the difference between Fitts law and Hick-Hyman. Okay, now I will go to, I will close all this. Okay. Okay, one minute. So sorry, I think I forget to change this. Okay, now I have changed this. Okay, now you can go and fill this form. Okay, small error. Go and fill form for attendance. Okay. Change permission setting. Okay, here is related to issue related to this. Use this form. Okay. Sometimes I forget to change the settings. So here are some difficulties. Now you can go and fill this form. Okay. So more, I will allow you more 5 minutes to fill this form. Okay. So, okay, now we will go to our topic related to difference between Fitts law and Hick-Hyman. So there is no such differences in Hick-Hyman and Fitts law. So normally Hick-Hyman laws and Fitts law are two surviving human performance principle based on Shannon and Weaver's information theory. So already have shown the Shannon theorem. Okay, then in early 1980s Card and Moran novel presented the law as design principle for developer to maximize usability in the design of human computer interface. So earlier in systems uses this Hick-Hyman laws and Fitts laws. And a search of the current human-computer interactions literature will reveal that the Hick-Hyman laws fail to gain momentum in the field of SCI. Okay, so we will not discuss about this Hick-Hyman law, but in coming topics, if we needed this Hick-Hyman law, we will discuss about this law. Okay, and whereas Fitts law received and continues to receive substantial attention for software engineering purpose also, and for device development also. And here is this article provides begin with the discussion about common information theoretical concepts of two laws, and then examines each of laws with respect to its origin and theoretical formulations. Okay, so there is no such differences related to this. Okay, so here you can read from this. Here is the investigation of Fitts law using a wide range of movement amplitudes, and Fitts law as a research and design tools in human computer interactions. Okay, and then dual task performance and Hick-Hyman law of choice reaction time. So these are the different articles that will show you the Hick-Hyman and Fitts law related details. Okay, then there is another. Okay, here is the comparison of Hick-Hyman and Fitts law. So here is the research paper. Okay, information theoretic model of SCI in comparison of Hick-Hyman laws and Fitts law. In this paper you can identify the difference between these two laws. Okay, so I will not go in detail about this paper. Okay, so I will show only some limited information about this differences. Okay, so I think we will go original experiments. Okay, here is we will go to last topic. Okay, so we will get the proper detail about this. Okay. Okay, here are some examples related to Hicks. Okay, So these are devices mainly developed or designed using Higgs, okay? And there is Hyman's related devices for you can say visualization purpose, okay? And there is also sensors, okay? Throat microphone, okay? Using throat microphone. So maybe these devices are developed or designed using Hyman's. So we will go to our main topic difference, if we will find here, okay? I think we will get it. Conclusion, okay? So the validity and theoretic roots and quantitative caliber of the law seems unlikely to be a significant factor that prevented the Hyman law, okay, from gaining momentum in SCI. Again, you can say here, Hyman law not provide some more detail about interaction, okay? So here you can see, first, the inherent difficulty in applying the law is obvious, okay? There is a difficulty related to Hyman, and this is likely to due to relatively more complex simile in SCI, okay? And additionally, in an inability to account for performance in a highly familiar or automated or trained task may have also been limited the law's applicability to SCI problems. But Fitts law is useful for SCI design, okay? And again, within this limits, the relationship between information load and choice reactions time captured by the Hyman law is robust and demonstrable at the basic level. So there is the limitation related to Hyman law, and so mostly it is not used nowadays. Only Fitts law is used for designing SCI devices, okay? So now today's class is over, okay? I think already you have filled this form, okay? I will give you link again. Okay, some students have already filled. 25 students already filled this form, and we have 21. Okay. I will give you the form again. Copy. Okay. Okay, fill this form and I will open it for 11:30, okay, for attendance purpose. So now you can leave one by one, and if any issue related to this Fitts law topic, you can mail me or you can message on our class Google Classroom, okay?